Hi everyone, my name is Richard and I work for App Marketing Agentur, and we do exactly what the name says. We gathered here like four ASO heavyweights, and we talk about ASO, which is not dead. It's still like a valid method of user generation, user acquisition. It's the biggest benefit, obviously, it's free, and most of the installs still come from the search, so it's a very important topic to talk about. And just wanted to, you know, let the panelists introduce themselves, starting with you, maybe.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ekaterina, and I'm working at Rocket Internet. So for the last 2 years, my goal was to provide with the ASO support and guidelines for our ventures. So in any case, if they have any questions, they want to optimize their keywords, they don't know how to launch the application and what should be on their app page, they always contact me and I help them to do this.
Hi, I'm Moritz Dan. I run a mobile growth consultancy agency called Feature. We help apps grow their businesses with all different kinds of tactics based on the mobile growth stack, which my colleague Andy Carvel developed at SoundCloud. I've done ASO at SoundCloud for 2 years and then set up this agency. I've done now over ASO for over 20 different apps. Also publisher of the ASO Monthly, which is a digest with all the news of tools, algorithm changes, new best practices around conversion rate optimization, et cetera, that we bundle in a monthly digest.
Hi, I'm Adeline, and I'm a director of product at Clue. And what does that mean? I look into new markets, localization, exploration of what kind of features can we work on, and of course, App Store optimization as well. And for people who don't know Clue, Clue is an app where we are a female health app, and we provide a lot of insights to our users, and we pride a lot on using science and data to make cycle predictions, so people are, for our users, they are able to know when's their next period coming, when's their fertile window, if this is the right time to go home and have some fun so you can get some babies, or when it's the PMS time and so the partners can buy flowers and bring it back for their beloved ones. So that is Clue. And basically, Clue, we do a lot of different ASO as well, both on iTunes as well as Google, and I'm looking forward to share our experiences in the panel.
Yeah, hi, I'm James Eggleston. I'm CTO at AppScatter. Primarily, AppScatter focuses on distribution, but we're also looking at how we can use App Store optimization across multiple stores rather than just Google and Apple.
Okay, nice. So let's start with an easy question, like a warm-up question. You know, we are doing, as an agency, ASO since, you know, ever you could do it, basically the beginning. And ASO has also, you know, come a long way, and things have changed, and things are changing at the moment very much. So question would be, what's the biggest trend in ASO to expect in 2017? I mean, must be probably, you know, interesting for you dealing with lots of different products, I understand, at Rocket Internet. So what do you focus on in 2017?
Yeah, it's still not started yet, but for us search ads, of course, it's a big thing. Even though we are not really focused on US, so that's why we cannot fully test this new tool, but some of our companies try to benefit, and hopefully if we will have a case, like our question to discuss it, I can like disclose some information and say how we can benefit from it. Search ads, it's very important and also helps us to do better ASO. I mean, the classic one, like keyword optimization, to find out what keywords actually drive. And with this small budget, it's a great thing. Another issue is about app descriptions in Apple Store. Yes, it's already a part of the ranking because somehow it's a part of metadata in search ads. And I also believe, as Thomas said, that it's gonna be soon one of the ranking factors in App Store. And maybe the last one, I'm really curious what Google is gonna do further, because with the latest announcements of app indexing, private data indexing, accelerated mobile pages, progressive web apps. It's not really clear what should be direction for big companies, but for big e-commerce websites, where to go for apps, for progressive web apps, still like keep to be their presence on web or focus on the application and native applications.
Mm. Okay. So Moritz, you're running an agency as well. What will have the biggest impact in 2017, you think? And what did have the biggest impact in 2016? And what's going to change?
Yeah, I don't think it's a super easy question. You said it's an easy warm-up question looking into the future. But I think I've now done ASO for, I think, over 3 years. When I started, it was all about keyword optimization, right? I think there was a lot of big gains that you could still have from keyword optimization. Not everyone was doing best practices yet. No one was using tools for that. No one was really developing a methodology around that. And now there's so many billion of apps in the app stores, millions, that it's super hard to compete with keyword optimization. And I think that actually what happened in 2016 and kind of the end of 2015 was people were a bit fed up with not really having concrete data behind the return on investment of keyword optimization. And Google Play launching this great tool, the store listing experiments. We've already done experimentation at SoundCloud on conversion rates in the beginning that I joined there. But now that Google had rolled out at the end of 2015 that playlisting, store listing experiments, I think everyone could finally kind of get their hands dirty with conversion rate optimization. I saw a lot of publishers and agencies actually offering new services around conversion rate optimization rather than keyword optimization. And I think the trust has gotten back a little bit with keyword optimization, because of the search ads and the volumes that they now give away, that also backed up by the fact that Thomas mentioned it earlier today, that 2/3 of all installs come from search, and nearly half of that, Google just published, I think 3 weeks ago, published that number, nearly half of that is coming from broad searches rather than brand searches. And I think that realization suddenly at least gave me an impulse, like, hey, keyword optimization is not that at all. Actually, we now have a tool that gives us volumes for searches, and we're backed up by this thing that Google now said, like 33% of all installs come from broad search.
So the tool you're mentioning is the
Apple Search Ads.
Okay, and also like the optimization, the conversion optimization is done through experiments. Is that what you're saying?
That was Google Play store listing experiments, and also of course the tools like TestNest and Splitmetrics that now offer these services. But store listing experiments made it a bit more mainstream to actually work on conversion rate optimization.
Okay, so basically keyword search is kind of
We'll find a balance again between keyword optimization and conversion rate optimization. I see that balance already appear again, where everyone was super psyched about conversion rate optimization in 2016. I think 2017 will finally have this balance between increasing visibility by keyword optimization.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I personally, you know, always got a bit frustrated about, you know, the lack of information you actually get, or information in terms of return on investment you actually get from your ASO campaign. Yeah. You have to do it like ongoingly and monitor it to see, you know, proper results. But, you know, very often it's kind of more like a one-off thing, and then you don't see proper return on investment. But obviously with your approach, that might be different.
Yeah, I think you can put a number behind it now.
Exactly.
I tried to do that in the beginning days at SoundCloud, and I spent way too much time on spreadsheets. And now maybe I'll go back into those spreadsheets again and actually use the actual search volume data. Yeah.
Nice. What about you, Adeline?
I would say the trend in 2017 would be that the whole ASO topic, I mean, today itself, we saw a lot of different people talking about ASO. I think it will become a much more important topic to companies. People will take it a bit more seriously. It's no longer just okay, it's something that I need to do on the App Store just because I have a new release, it's going to be taken seriously whether the description is right, the screenshots are right, what it's going to be something that is no longer just we need to do it just because we have to do it. So I think it will probably evolve to become a more serious discipline in 2017, and that's taking the perspective of the app companies itself. And because I feel like it's going to be a more serious discipline, this in return, I would assume all this black hat ASO stuff that has been kind of in between all this chatter will be probably even more rampant, because then it means there's more opportunities for all these companies to offer rewards in order to help these companies have better ratings, better downloads. So it's kind of a good thing for companies that they're taking it seriously, but on the other hand, it's also encouraging another new business opportunity on the other hand.
Okay.
I agree exactly with that. The people in this room obviously know ASO is very important, but there's lots of industries where people aren't putting the effort in on a regular basis. And certainly, if you look at the gaming industry and gambling, which is heavily populated, these guys are relying on very expensive paid campaigns to get players into their systems, and they're just assuming that ASO won't help them. But actually, they're starting to realise now that investing in ASO as well as the paid campaigns is very important.
Well, I know, you know, gambling companies who invest in ASO heavily, you know, like kind of ASO tricks, so to say.
Mm-hmm.
Which leads us to our next topic. I hope this is going to work now. Can we do a slide? Go back. Okay, yeah. So I don't know if you heard, but Google announced that they go about fake reviews, which is, you know, a quite bold move. They try to remove fake or incentivized reviews, which means in the past you could easily approach an agency, not us obviously, but other agencies, which then provide fake reviews in order, you know, to get higher in the search result rankings. Google obviously then introduced now, or will introduce, algorithms to kind of prevent that. And that leads to a topic which is obviously common, not just in ASO, but in the whole of the app marketing industry, which is like a gray hat, white hat, black hat methods. You know, so the question is, for my panelists, obviously we're all assuming that none of these apps do any black hat or gray hat activities. So, but I just wanted to see, you know, what's the stance on these activities, and how far can you actually go as an app? Because obviously you have clear benefits using black hat, which basically means you don't stick to the guidelines Google tell you or Apple tells you, which means they can basically throw you out if they catch you. So you can see here some things, some methods which are used in the black hat world. Obviously, looking at the top one is incentivized installs. It's kind of not really gray. It's more like white gray. You still pay somebody to do something for you, but it's, you know, it's kind of heavily used and commonly used in the app marketing industry. So the question is, can you all see the things here? So the question is, you know, what are you using, or what do you recommend not to use? Where to draw the line between what you should do and what you shouldn't do as an app? Maybe you start at the other end.
Yeah, sure. I mean, yeah. It's a very interesting question. I think there's always going to be people that are trying to find ways around the algorithm, so it's all down to how you want to take that. I think when you're using bots, which really just comes down to how well you can program those bots to do those installs, that is a little bit extreme. But some of the others may not be seen so bad. Keyword stuffing all depends down on the algorithm, really. If you're benefiting from stuffing keywords and it helps you with your ASO, then is that considered gray, black, or white?
I mean, the bots nowadays, you know, they go that far that they're not just do the install, but they come back.
Yep.
And, you know, the campaign manager then looks at the data and sees, oh, well, nice, you know, good retention rate. But still, you know, it's kind of really sophisticated bots doing these things. What do you think?
I'll just pick a very simple topic, incentivized reviews. So that's kind of a interesting topic because on one hand, you can say that you're paying somebody to give you a review, and that's totally black hat. And but then on the other hand, if you think about it, if you were to actually ask very valuable questions or you incentivize in a appropriate way, then it can be kind of grayish. So I don't know. I mean, like my position on this particular topic, because I think everybody in the that who is working in an app company is always thinking about ratings, as in like, am I getting my 5-star ratings? Am I getting my 4.8 star ratings? And this is also a topic that we constantly discuss, and I stand with, it depends on the incentive. I mean, if it's something relevant, then maybe it's acceptable. It has to be case by case, and I'm not being judgmental about it. But if it's totally two different things, then no, because then, yeah, then that's totally black hat.
I mean, some things just become obsolete because of, you know, kind of structural changes, because Apple, for example, just introduced like a 30 characters title. So in the past you had like really super long keyword subtitles, so that's not possible anymore. So, but I think you are quite the expert in black hat, because this is a list actually coming from your presentation you sent me. So what's your take on
the total expert? No, I think it's really good to have this.
Well, in a positive way, I mean.
Yeah. I think it's totally good to have this debate, and I actually gave a presentation on this 3 weeks ago, where I called out all these different types of white, gray, and black hat tactics that you can be using. And it's really hard to draw the line. Actually, Apple says in their guidelines, they're talking about crossing the line, and that you can't cross the line. Basically, that's their guidelines. And they say, they actually quote a Supreme Court justice who once said to someone who asked where that line was, "I know it when I see it, and I think you know it too." And I don't think actually that most App Store marketers have that same moral compass. So that's why I think it's really good to have this discussion in a public forum. I think actually incentivized reviews is a good one, where I would also not have a real issue with kind of giving away a free wallpaper or so, in return for not a 5-star rating, but in return for a rating, because then Apple actually and Google have more data to go off. However, Apple had clearly the stance that's not allowed. And actually together with Clue, I work with Clue as well, we spotted one of their competitors doing this and actually stealing away a lot of Clue's downloads. And how we found that out was because we went into that specific competitor's app. They always had like 50,000 ratings in the Apple App Store, all 5 stars. And we actually manually went through the ratings, and suddenly we saw a couple of ratings that were saying, instead of "great app," they were saying, "I actually just tried it for the first time, but I want to unlock my free wallpaper." And people do that. And actually that competitor was asking specifically, like, "Hey, you get the free wallpaper if you give us 5 stars. And I think that's pretty clear that is black hat. And it's really important to have this discussion, because then we all know what rules we have to play by, because Apple and Google aren't actually giving us those rules. Also for a good reason, because if they would give us those rules, there would always be someone trying to maneuver around them. So I think, really having those discussions, and then knowing, as all App Store marketers, okay, this is where we draw the line as a industry. That is important, so that we can then also see what black hat competitors are doing and report them to Apple and Google. We did that with the competitor, and they got removed from the App Store.
So there are actually cases which got removed because of fake reviews and
yeah.
Things.
Yeah. 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 So it's really important to be in the know about all your what competitors might be doing. And I published the presentation also on SlideShare. So if you just Google for black hat ASO, you see all these tactics there as well. But I do think that incentivized reviews, whereas I don't have a moral issue with that per se, I do have the feeling that's for me really kind of crossing the line where we should sit.
Okay. What about Rocket?
I would say nowadays we don't have white hat ASO. I think it's all gray. Because maybe in early days we was trying to like provide with the full information about the app, trying to attract users, but now there are so many applications, so you just can't, you have to do this in order to get your customer, to attract them. I'm a big fan of localization, and actually when you are launching in 10 different countries at the same time, you have to deal with this, so you cannot avoid it. And the thing is, maybe in certain term, yeah, it can be a gray hat, because if you're not focused on this particular country, on this particular market, why you need to like provide keywords in this language. But at the same time, who knows, maybe there are some, I don't know, foreigners, expats coming to your country and they might use your application. And you want to make it very easy to find and provide the best offer you can offer for them as well, even though there can be just temporary users. So why not to use this? And in terms of reviews, it's just like the favorite topics, I guess, right now. What we also do in general, I guess, Google Play, like the fact that you can answer reviews in Google Play, it's already kind of gray hat. What we are doing sometimes, if you see there is a negative review regarding one of the features, something is not working for the application, for a particular user or type of devices, we are trying to fix this issue and came back to the user, said, okay, could you please check again? And maybe you will change your mind about our application, because we know when you're angry, we are really try to make it even worse for the actual company. So, and somehow I think it's a great tactic and a gray hat ASO, but at the same time, we are improving our product, customers happy because the application is working well. So at the same time, both benefit from it, so why not?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, marketing in general is like, you know, trying to make the most out of your marketing budget, and if you're still within the guidelines, even if it's gray, I think should be all right. And plus, basically, that's how the industry works nowadays, isn't it? I mean, that's the obviously a marketing principle in general, I find. But okay, let's move on. Let's move to iTunes search ads, which is, we heard something about before that. It's kind of a mixture between organic, you know, ASO and paid ASO, if you will, because, you know, obviously you can get to a top ranking without doing anything, without but just you have to pay, obviously. So the question is, what do you see, you know, is the connection between ASO and search ads? I mean, think of, you know, conversion optimization, and have you used that, like conversion optimization in the sense of that you actually, what we talked about before, that you know which keyword converts, which search string has this kind of retention rate, and that you have this stepped and granular data in order to make, you know, better decisions. Because as we said earlier, the ASO has been quite of a guessing game, so the search ads along with the Google campaigns, obviously AdWords campaigns, bring much more clarity in the ASO world. So the question is, are you using iTunes search ads already, and, you know, how do you value the data you get from that?
I personally didn't like do any ads, but I have some insight of some of our ventures on this. It's pretty interesting. What we also try to do now, and I'm in process, it's basically to evaluate all the ASO tools that we are using right now, how precise they are in terms of search volume. And yes, Thomas also mentioned AppTweak is one of like the best ones right now, at least what we are using. That's one part. Another part is, again, what I already touched in the previous question. We try to target also expats and people like who are traveling. So what we do, we with only US store search ads, we try to target those customers for our applications and other markets.
Okay.
So, and of course, it's really, really hard to find the right keywords and to let them work, but at the same time, you can make sure that you will get them. Okay. You will not lose them just because you cannot compete with the US apps or within US app store.
Now that Rocket Internet is a company with lots of money, and we heard earlier that it's expected that there is going to be a bidding war for the top position, because as far as I know, there's only one position in the app store you can bid on, right? Unlike the Google web search where you have like six or so on one on page one. So do you think like a big company will outbid and just spend so much more money in order to get to number one that the smaller developers, smaller companies suffer under that?
I mean,
like a bidding war?
Right now we don't see this because it's just a very, very limited market. Not everybody actually got the idea of search ads yet. We'll see in future, but I think it's also there will be a score how relevant is this particular ad, even though you might spend
which
a lot of
money. Which depends on the keyword, on the
keyword,
description,
your
I
description,
heard.
And so on. So if you're ready to pay, maybe you should also ready to pay for your ASO expert to optimize your page and make sure that actually what you're bidding is about your application. Mm-hmm.
I mean, we shall see how what's the click-through rate for the search ads. I think in the Google web search is like, I don't know, 25% on the ads or a bit more, and you know the rest 60% is on organic results. Maybe this is going to be the same in the Apple App Store. Depends obviously how it's going to be structured, how it's designed. Are you doing iTunes search already?
Very little, and I actually just would refer to Thomas' talk. I hope the presentation will be available online. We're using it really for apps optimization. So going into the tools that actually make use of that data, right? And to I think what Thomas described today, like being able to measure on a search term what the what your return on investment is, basically, or your retention rates. That's super interesting to use that data then subsequently in doing your keyword optimization. I think that's super interesting.
But isn't it going to be a big relief when you remember you're using all these ASO tools and then they bring back the volume of the searches, and sometimes they bring back really funny numbers, so at some point I didn't trust these tools anymore. And I think the iTunes search ads are probably based on real data, so probably much more trustworthy in terms of how high is the search volume. Should I go for that keyword or should I go for more like long tail keyword? I guess that's going to be a big improvement.
Totally agree.
Okay, what do you see? iTunes search ads?
To be super honest, we are not doing anything yet, but I did sign up during the break after Thomas's talk, and I got $100. I'm sure I'll be trying it very soon.
Okay.
Much the same. Search isn't really key to us because we're a distribution platform, but I certainly think it's difficult to imagine a time when it's not going to be bidding and wars.
Okay, so I'm going to skip the next question. So the last question is going to be an interesting one. Maybe I get the same answers like for search ads, but always want to be on the pulse of time. It's about iMessages. I hope somebody of you have used them so far. I don't know if the audience knows iMessage and the App Store in the iMessage is basically the platform in the platform. You can, from an iMessage, send application, install applications, use applications right from the search, from the box where you type in your message. So, and I heard that lots of, or especially, chat-related apps or kind of socially related app gained a lot of downloads coming from that iMessage platform. So the question is, do you think it's going to be a proper user acquisition channel in the future, the iMessage, or is it just like that kind of sticker thing? I think we even have a picture. I quickly turn on the PowerPoint. So basically, it's at the moment it's very much sticker based, and sometimes the stickers are kind of really.
This is the wrong PowerPoint.
Okay, this one. You see, that's basically the iMessage. Then you can go to in the middle is the store where you can install apps, and then as a result you get messages on the right hand side, so you can do whatever you want. It's very interactive, obviously. Depending on the app you're using in the iMessage. So the question is, is it going to be a user acquisition channel in the future? Have you used it? Are you thinking about using it? What do you think?
We definitely are looking into it, but we don't really start anything yet. And to be honest, I would like to see someone achieve any success with this, and then we will maybe try it out. Because right now, for me, it's not really very smooth experience, as well as with like Facebook Messenger bots and so on. It's a bit too long process of choosing the right product, to go back again the conversation. You have to scroll so many times in order to find something. Mm. I think for user, it's easier to just go to the right app and use it. Yeah. Because now they're super, super
I think advanced. So far, predominantly, like content-based apps have gained from that. Like, you know, apps who provide stickers or, you know, Giphy, the likes, you know, which provide funny content you can put in a message. Have you used iMessage, any experiences?
So one, I haven't used it personally. One of our clients actually did launch, was a launch partner for WWDC this year, and they did it to get featured. Even from the featuring, they didn't get that many downloads. For them, it's not really a super super great UA mm-hmm. strategy so far. Mm-hmm. That said, I mean, the platform can develop. I do mm-hmm. agree with you that for now, it's more kind of mm-hmm. sticker-based content that will probably mm-hmm. benefit a lot. I can imagine that you can easily send your location or send a ETA that people can track your ETA for a navigation app, for example. I can imagine use cases where it's super valuable. I think not every app will really benefit from iMessages. Mm-hmm.
What about female health apps? Do they benefit from this?
Interesting. I don't know. Well, it depends. I don't know how the whole feature and functionality is, but if it's based on some of the keywords you're typing in the iMessage, the question would be how many people would be discussing about their cycle, but then it would be, I think, at least for directly to Clue, it would be a little bit of a hard sell using iMessage. So I would say that this feature would be very appealing depending on the type of app category. And it probably will appeal a lot more to the more entertainment and fun category more than the serious ones as well.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting subject. I'm not too familiar with iMessage itself, but chatbots, I think, are an interesting area that we're moving into, where people who might be using, say, Slack, for example, want to get some information from a platform that's on your mobile device, but you can just ask that platform a question and get the results there and then before you go and open the app. And I think we're going to see more and more large-scale platforms moving into this to its complement rather than replace the mobile strategy.
Okay. I don't know how you actually get into the chat in the iMessage store. Do you have to develop a completely new app, or is it just like a derivation of your app? Does anybody know?
There was someone posting a Medium post how easy it was. I think it's a 7-step process to get their stickers up in the App Store, a designer who actually managed to get it up in less than 24 hours. So you don't even need, I think, engineering resources for it. But I'm not entirely sure.
Okay, cool. James is kind of urging me to finish now. So we thank you very much for the panelists. It was very interesting. So maybe give a hand for the panelists, and thank you very much for your time.